How bad the situation, circumstance might be right now, I know God is in control, and I know the purpose for me, so I'm going to make it through it, no matter how bad it is right now. All right, I say to forgive others. All right, who can tell me how old Joseph was? Jacob, Israel, was when he died. Finally died. Close. 40 years too much. 147 years old.
I think something like
that. Jacob, 147 years old when he died. 147 years old when he died. That was the purpose for his life. He knew the purpose was to preserve a people, keep a people alive. He didn't know how. He had to be the matriarch through several deaths, disappointments, lost his son, and all kinds of stuff. He had to keep the promise of God alive in that family. The purpose of Jacob's family was to, as you look over the whole picture, save a people, save a world. Now Joseph, just for informational pieces, Joseph lived until he was 110 years old in the land of Egypt. He finished out the rest of his life in Egypt. 110 years old when he died. I was just talking to some of my family members, they wouldn't go along with it, but Joseph saw his great grandkids. Ain't that a blessing?
That is.
I'm tripping up my grandkids.
This
year. She's 101. All right, yeah, you gotta get up and go. So, Candy's father is 82. He has a grandson, which is my great grandson, which is my grandson, who happens to be 6.
Yeah.
And 10 years from now, he can start producing kids. So we could have some great just 10 years from now.
Oh, maybe.
I couldn't get him to go along with that little child. 10 years from now, he'll be 60. Called Jessica, and in 3 more years, you can have a lot too. People have issues following plans. I see how Moses had an issue with the people of Israel, but Jessica wouldn't go. What a great blessing that is. Okay, so.
Kristen said Christmas will be the age Moses was if he got married.
Look at Genesis 50 and 24 to bring out what I just said. Genesis 50, 24. If you're there, right quick, go ahead and read it. 50th chapter, verse 24 and 25. No, that's not it. Okay, well, we'll hold off on that. Let's talk about forgiveness then. How many have been hurt by somebody? Kind of way or another, okay. Now, there are types. There's different kind of ways of forgiveness. So listen to the Bible. Types of forgiveness, different kind of ways of forgiveness. Interesting. Let's see here, Matthew 18:15. Stepping out on the limb here, let's say. Matthew 18:15. About Joseph, he had to forgive. Okay, well, we got verse 15 of Matthew 18. Someone read it.
Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother.
All right, if your brother should offend you, hurt you in any kind of way, go to him and let him know. What happened? It's a is what you did to me and it hurt me. And if he hears you, you have gained your brother. I got 8 brothers, and they have not recently, but within that 8 sibling structure, I think number 6 got to number 5, messed him up just real recently. Rental house, all kinds of things. And 5, 6, and the last one, number 8. Number 8 is the landlord. The other 2 are tenants, and they wouldn't pay the rent out of us, so he kicked them all out. Oh, the yogurt hit the fan. He came down from Colorado, took the keys, changed the door locks, and be out on the street. You don't pay, you broke the door, all this kind of stuff. Guess who gets the phone call? Sibling number 1. That'd be me. And what did I do? I hang it up. Y'all got to figure that out. I ain't hitting out. So, brothers do get into it.
Yeah.
Husband and wives get into it. I don't just jump a beat, brother. So it happens all the time. Somebody's gonna get to you. What are you gonna do? Stay mad the rest of your life? Go to your brother, go to them and say, this is scripture. And if he hears you, you gain him back. You want him back. If he messed you up, you go tell him how he hurt you. If he hears you, you want him back. Scripture. I didn't write it, it's right there.
Oh.
Easy or hard to do?
Hard.
Joseph, speaking to the rest of that bunch, you sold me into slavery. Been down here in this dungeon. Almost got killed. Oh, what could he could have brought all that up. Didn't bring it up. And he says, don't worry about it. God worked me through it. I see a purpose, God's purpose in my life. You don't understand it. You messed me up. Yeah, you did. You sure did mess me up. God worked me through it, and I've got a purpose in life. That's the only way I know how you can begin. I know what my purpose in life is. I know God's with me. God even knows how you messed me up. Bam. God's got it. I'm letting you know I'm forgiven. You ain't holding me back for me not forgiving you. It's okay. I'm going to treat you good. Ooh, that makes it even warmer up here. Luke 17:3-4. Another way to forgive. Luke 17:3-4. There's another way to do it. You read it, somebody. Somebody else read it.
Take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespass against thee, rebuke him. Mm. And if he repent, forgive him. And if he trespass against thee 7 times a day, and 7 times in a day turn again to thee, saying, I repent, thou should forgive him.
Ooh. Power of forgiveness. Strength. The strength comes from whom you know you are in the Lord, and you know God's purpose for your life. And he says, if your brother hurts you, rebuke him. Tell him, you messed up. You did this, that. You 100% wrong. You shouldn't have done that to me. And then do what? Forgive him. If he repent, forgive him. He says, I'm sorry, forgive him. And what if he's this type of character that has the potential to do it all the time? Stole from me yesterday, stealing from me today.
Watch it tomorrow.
So here's what I get out of this. People are going to hurt you if you're around.
Oh, yeah.
People are going to hurt you. I wish I could fix it and say you're going to walk through this life on this and you don't walk into heaven and nobody's ever going to get to you, but somebody's going to do you wrong. That's what he's saying.
Don't work like that.
Don't work like that. So what do you got to do? You got to forgive. And that's it. And so there you go, Sarah. We got one more way. Verses 13 and 14 of Luke. Of this same Luke. 13 and 14. Let's see what it says. Okay. Someone read that.
And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Mm-hmm. And when he saw them, he said unto them, go show yourselves to the priests. And it came to pass that as they went, they were clean.
They were cleansed. That's right. And this is the deal, is that if you know how to forgive, if you are forgiven, and you demonstrate your, you say, rehabilitation, you know that the Lord has showed mercy on you, others is going to see it. The way to get God's mercy is to get in repentance and into forgiveness. I think Pastor Hill was preaching the other day about somebody said they owed him some money, some biblical scripture, and he wouldn't, one guy wouldn't pay. And then he said, turn around, he owed somebody some money, and he went to the man, and the man says, he owed you, and you wouldn't, you threw him in jail, and now you come, he says, no, it don't work like that. So, forgiveness is a tough thing to do, but the only way you can do it is know your purpose, know that God is all sovereign. I know you've been hurt, you've been burned, but that's the way it is. You gotta. The story about Joseph, who was done worse than him? All people. Okay, so let's get to the lesson today. Let's try and start with the. I know we're starting with Genesis, the 50th chapter, but I'm going to take a quick look at Genesis, the 46th chapter. Hate us and will certainly require us all the evil which we did unto him. The dad is dead, and a little bit later we can get into some scriptures where we can see that before Jacob died, he had a meeting with Joseph. And well, we know the history that Joseph really cared for his brothers. We saw about how they wept last week over each other. Give this episode. Joseph put him in positions to get the best of what's going to be going on in Egypt. Best food, best everything. I built a rooted curve. Then all of a sudden, but the old man, Jacob, he's getting old. He's going to die. He dies. And then the brothers, they're thinking, man, you know, did he really forgive us? I mean, you know, he's been treated as good. Maybe he was holding off because the patriarch is still alive. And he waited to dad died to do his dirty stuff, to take his revenge on us. How many ever heard people waiting for an old man, old grandma? So I ain't gonna hurt you when mama's alive.
I'm looking for Genesis. Was
46:30. And Israel said unto Joseph, let me die, since I have seen thy face, because thou art yet alive. And Joseph said unto his brother, to his father's house, I will go up and show Pharaoh. Nah, that's not what I want. But so these brothers are worried. They are worried that Joseph is going to take revenge. Now, if you've ever forgiven somebody, and I'm talking about real life stuff, sometimes people don't feel like you could really genuinely give them a free pass. A free pass, but I forgot. It's over with. We treat you good. We tight. Don't worry about it. You know, guy's still watching his back, you know, stuff like that. So those brothers I ask the question, why didn't they really think that Joseph forgave them? There's tangible proof.
If only because they wouldn't have forgiven him.
I think they had a sin consciousness.
Well, everybody got sin consciousness. Yeah. But they were sin conscious about that sin.
That's what I said, sin consciousness.
I mean, he gave them all the tangibles that you think, I can't do no more. This is, I'm keeping you alive, giving you the best of the best, got you protected, bring your wives, your kids, everybody. We're sending the trucks and the trains, bringing it back over here. That's what he did. He did everything. It's powerful to take care of them. Then they felt, you know, I'm going to thank you.
See, deep down within, they know how badly they had treated him.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, really.
Can you really forgive somebody?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
But for them to even wonder about it, I think their man's probably, I don't know.
No, when you have a consciousness of how bad you are, sometimes you feel like you have a taste of it.
What about saints? Man, history bad thing has happened to me. I'm one of God's still mad. I wonder if I can measure up to God's grace. I think some people don't really have the concept of redemption and forgiveness really down pat. And God, how far he's from the west, remove sins, and get with people. People want you to pay. You messed over me, you pay. God, how can you forgive somebody like that? That's just too easy. The character between Joseph, that Joseph had, and what his brothers had, is quite a contrast. His brothers was some conniving, down to earth, dirty dogs. And Joseph is just the complete opposite. Sometimes it's like that in families. Because I'm a good one. Siblings mess over you all the time. You just do it. What am I supposed to do? Well, you got to know God has purpose for your life, and you got to know God's in control. And you got to also know, look at this example. The one that they was messing over rescued all. Because God had a purpose on his life. So sometimes the mercy of God is going to be using you to bring them dirty rascals into salvation. You don't know how, but you know that God has a purpose on my life. And they're subject to get saved. Oh boy. Okay, here we go again. All right, so they don't know. He's going to do evil on us. Someone read verse 16.
Send a messenger into Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying,
17.
So shall ye say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee now, the trespasses of thy brethren and their sin, for they did unto thee evil, and now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of thy father. And Joseph wept, and when they spake unto
Joseph, when they came talking to him, Joseph busted out crying. The question is going to be, why did Joseph cry? What did he know that they didn't know that he knew? Okay. And here they are again. What's making Joseph cry? Somebody help me out.
I think it was
the
sadness in Joseph's heart over his brothers all of that time. What he had done for them and all that maybe wondering if their hearts had really changed, their spirits had really changed.
You think Joseph really felt that it's in the past? You bring it up, it'll hurt. We got by that, now you bring it up.
maybe.
You think they bring some remembrance and make them cry?
Right.
And hurt them?
You often see that now with them.
Okay. I'm going to say Joseph was even above that. I think that was the deal that made him cry. What made him cry?
Yes, I've been this good to you all this time. How can you think that I could be as conniving as you were?
Yeah. I forgave you and you got the best of the best. It's been proven over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. You, your kids, your house, your everything. Got all your old raggedy stuff, brought it out of wherever you were, and brought it over here and gave you the best of the best. And now you're bringing up this crap again, acting like I'm going to take action against you. And father just died, and you're bringing up, first of all, you're bringing up the what? The mess. Oh, boy. That's why I'm in the business of selling
the mess. That may have been the work, but really got him is that they said that father played this rather, you would do this. And for them to say that, okay, our father didn't believe that you had forgiven us. He think that might have hurt him worse.
That hurt him too. I think that hurt him too. But he also knew that when Joseph, and I got to find that scripture, when Joseph talked with the dad that was dying, Jacob did not bring this crap up.
I don't think Jacob ever told them to tell him that.
No, that's reality. Jacob never did tell them. Joseph knows that they are what? Lying. Because he was there with the grandkids and talking to Jacob when Jacob was about to pass, and Jacob never, from the time he got over there to that land in Egypt, with Joseph never brought up what happened. What your brothers did. The only people bringing it up are the ones who's messed up.
But you know, making it more contemporary, sometimes when there's been a transgression committed against one, and if a person brings that up again, often the perpetrator will, that it evokes something within that perpetrator, because they're thinking, you know what, I thought we dealt with this.
Yeah.
And maybe this has already been discussed. So it does affect the perpetrator as well as the recipient of that, you know, if it's brought up again.
If the perpetrator does not know how to receive forgiveness, he'll never be able to walk straight.
That's right. That is right.
You don't know good stuff in the past. You don't know what. He's always looking over the ship, wondering. That's a tool of the devil, is to not give forgiveness and not receive forgiveness. Oh, because that's why Jesus said, no matter how bad you got hurt, he's hurting you 70 times in a day, forgive him. Forgive him. Why? Because it's to your advantage, your benefit, to give forgiveness. And if that guy is always like this, if they repent, if they say I'm sorry, if they recognize, rebuke him. If he says I'm sorry, forgive him, forgive him. Go to your brother, tell him. If he says, oh, I recognize now I hurt you, then you've gained your brother. But, if he's still hard-headed and all like that, you haven't gained him. You got to do it, brother. Who you say? Watch him. Because we're dealing with what? People. Yeah. Okay. Let's see what we can do here. Joseph wept. That's the last sentence in this prayer, in this verse here. And Joseph wept, and he wept because they didn't know how to receive forgiveness. That's why he's crying. And I want to see Genesis 45, verses 5 through 7. Let's see what we got. Okay, this is Joseph's attitude toward his brother. And Joseph said, and we'll go for verse 4, Genesis 45. Joseph said unto his brother, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near, and he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. Now therefore, be not grieved, or don't be afraid, nor angry with yourselves, that you sold me hither. For God did send me before you to do what? Preserve life. for these 2 years had the famine been in the land, and yet there are five in the which there should neither be Aaron our harvest, God sent me before you to preserve your great posterity in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So Joseph knew his purpose, and he can forgive him, okay? I went through all this, and God worked me through it, and I'm coming out good. And don't be angry, don't be afraid. And then he showed them all the best, gave them all the best. And them rocks were still alive. And they brought this mess up to Joseph again after the father died. It hurt Joseph. Okay, verse 18 of my lesson. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face. And they said, behold, we be thy what? Servants. So because they have, if you haven't received forgiveness, you are a slave to guess who? The devil is going to run you every kind of way and task you every kind of way possible if you don't think, if you do not receive forgiveness. Now, you say, I done walked this earth and I ain't offended nobody, so this doesn't apply to me. And you're going to be a devil. I ain't never offended nobody. I ain't never heard. The way the seven siblings of mine, they never been messed up. Yeah, so here it is. You have to, if you don't know how to receive forgiveness, you are a slave yourself. Ooh. Verse 19, Joseph said unto them, fear not, for I'm in, and verse 19, I'm going to read it like this in William's translation, says, I'm in God's perfect will. Fear, stop being so scared. I'm in God's perfect will. Right now. Great is the, what is the scripture? Great peace out of the love of the law. Nothing, you can't get to it. That's what Joseph was saying. I ain't thinking about y'all. I got, me and God got this thing going on here. That's a wind going on out there. So Joseph was saying, me and the Lord, me and God, Almighty God, we know what we're doing. I know what I'm doing because I know God's purpose for my life. And, you just can't hurt me. You just can't mess me over because I know. And God has proven it. The stuff I done come through, what can you do for me anyway? What are you so scared of? Why do I want to stoop down and mess with your mess anyway? I'm riding high with God. Fear not. Don't worry. That's what he's saying. Now, verse 20. But as for you, so he's giving a contrast between me and you. Him and his brothers. He's telling them what they're like. What is he saying in verse 20?
But as for you, he thought evil against me. Mm-hmm. But God meant it to do this, mm-hmm. to bring to pass, as it is this day. Save much people alive.
Yeah, so God didn't tell you to sell me into slavery. He had nothing to do with that. But he turned that for my good. Question to the class now, if Joseph had never been sold into Egypt, do you think his brothers and his fathers would have survived the famine?
Yes.
That's right. And when we get into our humanistic, finite intelligence, we're going to say, oh no, he had to go into Egypt to get that position to save the people. No, the deal is that they would have lived because God made promise long time ago to Abraham. And there ain't nothing going to happen on the earth to keep that promise being fulfilled.
Well, do you think if they had not have sold them in the slavery debt, it mean that the king had Joseph would have had it himself and would have put the plan in the work in their own land.
And it could have happened. Who knows how God would have brought that revelation to whoever to get to the king of Egypt.
And it could have been even another plan.
He could have worked out something else.
I didn't even told Abraham that they was going to be in slavery.
All we know, all you can stand on is the promises of what God said. Mm-hmm. No matter how bad it got for you, they throw you in jail tomorrow. Arrest Sister Hill. She stole that. some identity theft issues going on. Throw her in jail. She's dealing with the red light district girls and everybody else.
She knows her man.
How'd you get here? What am I? She don't have it. So I know what my life is called.
Right. I know.
Maybe I'm here to kind of preach to y'all. I know what my life is. Maybe I'm here to show you God's life in the flesh. Right? Jesus hung on that cross and said, Father, forgive them for they what? Don't know what they do. How can you forgive somebody that spit on your mama, calling your mama all kinds of names, hanging you, killing you? How are you going to forgive them? Hanging on. What? How are you going to do that? Jesus demonstrated. So you don't know what test you might have to go through to forgive somebody. Well, all you know is that, like your Lord, forgive also. Ooh, that's a tough lesson, but that is it. Okay, we're going to move through. We've got some powerful scriptures here. Now therefore, Joseph said, verse 21, fear not. Fear you not. I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly to them. Wow. This is after they came to his face with both face alive. Was Joseph just a wimp, or did he just have that kind of good stuff? Joseph dwelt in Egypt, he and his father's house, and Joseph lived 110 years. Now, we're going to get to the good stuff here. We understand the promises. You got to always look back on the promise when the yoke is hitting the fan in your life. You got to look at the word. You got to look at the word, because if not, you get thrown off track and you're going way off here and off there because of the circumstances and stuff that's going on. So when the yoga hits the fan, the first thing that I do is look at the word. Get it going back in my head. Get it back going in my spirit. Say, what did God say? What's the word say? Okay. Now, so Joseph was revealed the word over and over by Jacob. When Jacob got with them in Egypt, you can be assured that he reviewed the promise. Now here's the promise. It's going to be in Genesis 13, chapter verse 15 to 7. This is what every Jew stands on today. I mean every, every Hebrew. Stands on today. They should stand on this. Genesis 13, 15, and 7. Where does it say there? Let me read. Genesis 13, verses, let's go with verse 14 through 17. Genesis 13, verse 14.
And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thine art northward, and southward, and eastward, and westward, and all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered.
All right. Okay, so that's the promise. I'm going to give you this land that I'm showing you. When we get back in our lesson here, so that's the promise that they're standing on. And in verse 23 of our lesson, and Joseph, now Joseph's getting to be an old man now, and Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation. The children also of, how do you say this guy? Machir, the son of Manasseh, was brought up upon Joseph's knees. Now here's what we got to realize. When Joseph was in the land of Egypt and he became second in command, Pharaoh gave him a wife, right? Gave him a Hebrew wife.
An Egyptian.
What we got now? When the kids come out. Good operation. We'll just cut them in half. Half is Hebrew, we keep the other half. So now we got some mixed kids. So the question is, did Jacob accept Joseph's children?
Yes.
Chapter 48, Genesis 48. You're going to accept these mixed kids? And they get the promise as well? Right? Why the Bible mention something like this? Why would the Bible write this in?
I think
48.5. And now thy two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, which were born unto thee in the land of Egypt before I came unto thee into Egypt, are who? Those are my grandkids. Those are my grandkids. And he says, just like Reuben and Simeon are. They're mine too. Those two are full-blooded Hebrew, but these other two, guess what? They're mine too. Of mine too. And that comes from the patriarch. Okay, it says he brought them up and set them on Joseph's knees. So the children were all in the family. This day and age, there are mixed families. Am I right?
Yeah.
A lot of mixed families. This day and age, you find some folks that's a basketball star, he's supposed to know how to get a great job. Right, Brother Travis? She just got 75 million herself.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Come on, she married her. This folks didn't want to marry her because she wasn't happy at marriage.
Yeah.
She's probably saying, I'll agree with y'all. She didn't marry her. Yeah. 75 million. So she got 75 million. Wow. Okay, Joseph said it to his brethren. Joseph said, and it says in verse 24, his brethren, what he is saying here, as he's getting ready to die, he's talking to his people. It's not these bad actors we've been reading about. He's talking to his people. He's the patriarch now at this time, after Jacob has died. Joseph said unto his brethren, or his people, I die. Now, how many would like to have the courage to be able to say, don't worry about all that life support stuff, machines, pumping, all this and all that. The Lord's getting ready to take me home. I'm getting ready to die. Bring the family around. Got the last thing I want to say to him. He knows his purpose. He knows what he's here for. He knows. When you know, you know. So he's saying, please, I'm getting ready to die. I'm getting ready to go. Bring everybody around. God was surely, he's telling them, God is surely going to visit you and bring you out of this land. You know what he's doing? He's preaching to him for the last time. Like if I was on my deathbed and I said, well, I'm gonna give my family all this here, I'm gonna give my last supper. Gather up, get your Bibles. Open up to so-and-so. Here's the word of the Lord. here's the word of the Lord. That's what he's doing. Here's the word. Remember the word. Remember the promise. Why does the old man on the bed when you die have to reiterate this and put it in him and put it in and put it in? Because not only is Joseph getting old, ready to die, but the guy he has favor with is getting old and he's probably dead or gone or on his way to. So he's saying that things is going to be looking different. Remember, I fed, took care of y'all. I'm the main man of my second family. But when I die, guess who? They ain't going to them brothers of mine. They ain't giving them. They ain't getting nothing. You know, they ain't going to chill. You're going to be facing some challenges. Here's what you got to remember. The word. Remember the promise. So, and if you don't believe me, I'll show you here soon. Because this ends with Joseph dying. The book of Genesis ends with Joseph dying. And then we jump straight into the book of Exodus, and the question is, how long after Joseph died did it take for Israel to wind up in slavery? Yeah. God was taking care of us, he's gone. Now, when you turn over to the next page in the Bible, it's the book of Exodus, and it's saying something that ain't too good.
king over Israel.
Huh?
Over Egypt, and now there rose up a new king over Egypt.
There rose up a new king. But that didn't know nothing about Joseph. And here you go. I don't know about your granddad. No, who are you? What? Give me that car. Where you get that from? That was my granddad.
Yeah, no.
Hey, listen, that title says Egypt. That belongs to us. Now, house to everything else. You're slaves.
All of y'all.
Slaves. Whoa. I don't think it was immediately, but there was something that Israel did to cause them to wind up being punished and going into slavery. Best thing I can say, they forgot what they were taught.
It wasn't immediate.